おお、こいつはうまそうだ。
アンティパストはモッツァレラチーズとトマトのサラダです。
モッツァッツァ？
モッツァレラチーズは脂肪抜きした柔らかくて新鮮なチーズのことです。イタリアではみんな好んで食べてる。
Hey, what's up guys? Welcome back to Binging with Babish, where this week we're taking a look at the Caprese salad from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, Diamond is Unbreakable. Let's go eat some Italian food. Now, this is a rather simple Italian dish, and as such, it requires really high quality ingredients, tomatoes and mozzarella. You could, of course, buy fresh mozzarella, but let's make our own. For this task, we're going to need a few specialty items. First up, some optional cheese salt, which is pretty much just kosher salt that dissolves more quickly. Next up, some very non-optional citric acid and rennet, either animal or vegetable. Oh yeah, and you're gonna need a really good, really accurate thermometer. And let's see what else goes into cheese making. Oh, that's right, a whole lot of whole milk. A whole gallon of the highest quality, least pasteurized, least homogenized milk that you can get your hands on. Keep it nice and cold while we prepare our science stuff. First, we are combining 1 1/2 teaspoons of citric acid with 1 cup of cool, clear, non-chlorinated water. Next up, a 1/4 cup of cool, clear, non-chlorinated water with 1/4 teaspoon of rennet. Then we're headed over to the stovetop, where we're going to deposit our citric acid mixture into a large, wide stockpot, along with a full gallon of our artisanal small farm milk. Pour this from up on high like Willy Wonka's chocolate waterfall to make sure that everything is evenly mixed. Set the whole thing over medium-low flame, give it a few cursory mixes, and slowly, gently bring the milky mixture up to 90 degrees Fahrenheit. The more precise you are with your temperatures throughout this process, the better. So not only kill the heat, but pull the whole pot off the heat the very second that you hit 90 degrees Fahrenheit, and then pour in your diluted rennet mixture and mix with an up and down motion for exactly 30 seconds. Once 30 seconds have elapsed, it's time to let this guy coagulate. So we're gonna pop a pot lid on the... Hang on a second. We're gonna pop a pot lid on there and let it sit for at least 5 minutes, being careful not to make any silly faces in the pot lid for the camera, and returning after 5 minutes to check on the state of your curd. It should look like a layer of fat-free Greek-style yogurt has formed on the top of your milk, which we're now going to use a long, thin knife to cut into 1-inch pieces, being sure that the tip of the knife hits the bottom of the pot on each stroke. Then we're returning this guy over medium-low heat and gently giving him a stir, which, as you can see, is going to mix up the cheese matrix. Keep gently stirring and heating over medium-low heat until this guy reaches 110 degrees Fahrenheit. It is essential that you not go any higher than 110, otherwise your cheese might turn out squeaky. So remove the pot from the heat and continue to stir gently until the curds soften and become extraordinarily gelatinous, about 2 to 3 minutes. Now we're going to ladle out the curds into our nearest awaiting fine mesh sieve. And now we get into the part of the process that is the reason why I've avoided making cheese on this show thus far. You see, while my hands might appear manly, they have the heat tolerance of that of a small child, or the paws of an extremely temperamental Westminster show poodle. So once I'm all done double bagging my tender digits, it's time to finalize our cheese. First, we're going to season it with about a teaspoon of our cheese salt, and then we're going to remove the tons and tons of excess whey. I found that by lifting the cheese up and sort of tilting the sieve, I was able to remove most of the whey in short order. And then comes the process I've been dreading, heating and stretching the cheese. First, we're going to return all the drained whey back to our main pot, set that pot over medium-high heat, and bring the whole mixture up to 175 degrees Fahrenheit, aka the temperature at which you normally brew tea. We're then going to use this hot mixture to gently heat and stretch our cheese curds into mozzarella. So using a mesh spider thingy, I'm actually going to swap it out for a finer mesh spider thingy, or your hands if you're super, super brave and strong, we're going to dip about 1/3 of our curds into the hot whey and then pull it out and begin to stretch it like taffy. Ideally, we want to stretch it out and fold it on itself 4 to 6 times, so re-dip it as necessary to soften it up, and then once it becomes smooth and shiny and elastic, it's time to form it into a ball. We're going to do this the same way that we might do with bread dough, pressing it up between our fingers with our thumb to make a tight, taut little ball that we're going to pinch at the bottom, make sure it's smooth and round on top, and there you go, homemade mozzarella, which in order for it to keep its shape, we have to chill quickly. So into a bowl of cold water, we're going to add a couple tablespoons of our our whey, a few ice cubes, and a pinch of kosher salt. Mix it up to make sure that everybody's cold and dissolved, and drop your cheese ball right in. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, I have conquered one of my great on-camera fears, and you know the old Babishian saying, if I can do it, surely you can. Go ahead and store these in the fridge for up to 4 days in their brine, or let's use it to make some of Tonio's caprese. First, we have to make his special dressing, which, intriguingly enough, starts with a whole anchovy, finely minced, practically into a paste, to which we're going to add an equally exciting piece of dried seaweed. I totally see where he's coming from. This is going to add a lot of cool umami flavor if we can manage to crunch it up into little pieces. There we go. Just get that seaweed into a relatively fine powder, add it to the bowl, along with 2 tablespoons of white wine vinegar. Then the recipe calls for lemon juice. I'm just going to use half a lemon, since we already have vinegar in there, don't want too much acid. Then 2 tablespoons of high-quality olive oil, a little fat to help things emulsify. Then the recipe calls for salt, pepper, and etc. I don't really know what that is, so go ahead and add a little etc. And just a splash of balsamic vinegar. How about 2 splashes? Then you can either bring this to a state of emulsification with a tiny whisk or fork, or you could pour it into a tiny mason jar and give it a shake, which is going to perfectly emulsify everything together into a nice creamy dressing. Now to get ready to plate up our caprese salad. First, a few inexplicable leaves of lettuce garnish and a couple peculiar toast points, followed by our thin slices of tomato and mozzarella, for which we're going to need a very sharp knife. So I've got this wicked sharp little number that Joshua Weissman gave me, 5 slices of tomato and 4 slices of mozzarella, which we're going to start by stacking over on the left side, or is it the right side? I think it's the right side. Stacking alternately for both color and textural contrast into a neat little accordion of Italian accolade. Then after that, all we have to do is dress the... Wait a minute, did I do this backwards? Damn it. Make sure that your tomato and mozzarella slices are arranged in the correct orientation so as to be TV accurate. Fan them out into a caprese crescent and dress with our anchovy seaweed dressing, a decidedly non-traditional topping that I'm very excited to try. And even though it's curiously absent in the on-screen recipe, there are clearly 2 leaves of basil festooned on the left-hand side as a garnish. So now finally it's time to tuck in and see how everything came out. And I gotta say, this dressing really quite good. The anchovy and the seaweed are both huge umami boosters, so they're bringing a lot of savory acumen to the party, to the point where they received a fork shake of excellence. But I gotta be honest, it's hard enough to go without basil. I need some more balsamic in this situation. And with the addition of a little balsamic cream, we've got something truly worth scratching your skin off and blowing your teeth out over. Even made without Tonio's Pearl Jam stand, this is a project worth undertaking at home. Look, I even ate the lettuce like some kind of poser.
This is Binging with Babish, reading for Joseph Joestar. Action.
Oh no! Holy shit! Help me! Oh my god!
Oh no!
Oh my god!